Hey everyone, I'm Brittany Schuyler and welcome to Open. Coming up on today's show, we'll sit down with a nonprofit executive leader who will speak about the work that her organization is doing to celebrate women this Mother's Day and much more. Then we'll speak to the associate director and mentor ambassador of an organization that is changing young lives one mentor at a time. Plus, we'll speak to the daughter of a music icon who is making her mark on the music industry while paying homage to her father's legacy. Finally, we'll sit down with a gospel singer, actress, and an active board member of the African American Day Parade Board to highlight her latest work. So stay tuned, sit back, and relax, because we're now open. Hey everyone, I'm your host, Brittany Schuyler, filling in for Dr. Bob Lee, and you're now watching Open, the live and interactive program that brings the Bronx and New York City straight to your TV set. Stay connected with us through social media at BronxNet TV. Leading things off, our first guest is the nonprofit executive leader for United Way of Greater Union County. We'll speak to her about the work that her nonprofit organization is doing within the New Jersey community and to highlight an upcoming Mother's Day concert. Please welcome to the show, Julianne Cherry. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Of course. So just to kick things off, let's just talk about what is United Way of Greater Union County and what's its mission?
So the United Way of Greater Union County, we are one of the largest nonprofits in Greater Union County. This year we are celebrating 65 years of financial service. It is our mission to provide our families with resources for them to thrive. Traditionally, when you think about United Ways, normally United Ways fundraise to support other nonprofits. We do that, support and fund 25 different nonprofits in the Greater Union County. Also provide direct service programs at our Family Success Center, New Jersey Youth Corps.
That's amazing. Tell us a little bit about some of the programs and services offered by the organization.
Sure. So our Family Success Center is something that I'm extremely excited about. One, because we currently manage two Family Success Centers, one in Elizabeth, New Jersey, and the other in Hillside, New Jersey. Within the next couple months, we will be expanding our Family Success Center, moving to the city of Rahway, New Jersey. This Family Success Center will be a walk-in center where anyone can walk in and get access to different resources, such as utility assistance, rental assistance, it could be food, workforce development, resume building, really pretty much any resource for that family structure to thrive. When I think about the different people that walk into the center, the services will be very different. So for a mother, it may be maxi pads and diapers or formula or parenting class. For a youth, it may be workforce development or resume building or working with the family and dealing with the truancy. For a father, it may look like resume building and workforce development or providing some gently used clothing to get that father back in the workforce and for him to be able to be successful. So I'm really excited about that because I really think Family Success Centers are the cornerstone to success in our community.
Absolutely. You know, they do say it takes a village to raise a child and to raise a family. So I think that is so important that you're offering things in so many different realms, like you said, from utilities to resume writing to things that will help mothers postpartum and just beyond. So with that, can you tell us a little bit about how many locations does this organization have?
Currently we have three locations. We're located in our main office in Elizabeth, New Jersey, which is our administrative office. We have our Roselle office, which houses our New Jersey Youth Corps program. Our Youth Corps program is a program between ages that allows youth between ages of 16 to 24 to self-enroll in the program. It is a 20-week course that helps that youth obtain their high school diploma. Mm-hmm. And if high school diploma is not something that is within reach, we really strive to help them identify workforce development opportunities and find them some type of employment. We also, within those students, they also do 10 hours of community service a week, and we also provide life skills training. So that is our second location in Roselle. And then our third location is located at the Hillside High School, our Family Success Center, currently where we service and provide resources for over 1,000 families in the greater Union County.
That's amazing to hear. Now tell me, is there a particular way that you would, position your services based on the location? Or is it something that's like, hey, in this particular location, we see that there's a need of this, so let's try to make this our priority and so on and so forth?
Correct. So that's a really great question that you asked. Our team is really positioned really well because we work within our community. We go to where the need is. So the 25 plus community nonprofits that we work with, those are what I call our assets. So you'll often see us tabling opportunities at one of our community partners, because I'm a strong believer in, you know, if we are located in an area, let's say for example we are at a food camp, we want to make sure that we're providing other services in the community. So it may be us tabling opportunities to provide workforce development or family success, then we'll invite one of our community partners. You know, maybe you could do some doula or some resume building. And then we may invite another community partner that is able to provide food in that building. So our community partners are extremely important to success for our families.
I think that's so important to be able to bring certain services that are needed more in one community than another, because in that realm, you know, it's not, you don't feel like certain things are going to waste if somebody's not using them more, you know.
Exactly. And, you know, we also want to be able to kind of like support in the line. We want to make sure that our families have resources for them to thrive. Yeah, you know, my biggest fear is that a family or a person a $3 bus ride to our center. And, you know, we want to be able to give them every support in that moment. So it's always great that our community partners and our allies are with us to provide those resources.
Absolutely. And just tell me a little bit about what has the feedback been like from these services?
Oh, it's been amazing. So overwhelmingly, a lot of our parents, you know, when I came on board as the new president and CEO, one of the things that was very important for me is that we're no longer providing Band-Aid solutions. You know, we could easily, if someone walked in to our center, we could easily tell them, okay, well, they said that they're hungry. We could give them a gift card. However, we are taking it one step further. We're giving them a gift card. We're also providing resources in the community for them to get access to nutritious foods. And then we're also identifying what are the barriers to get to go back to employment. Is it their resume? Is it really how they navigate this thing called LinkedIn or Indeed? What help do they need for them to be successful? So we're really looking at the total family and the total person to help them out for them to be successful.
I love that phrase that you use, Band-Aid solutions, because just like you said, you can help a specific problem in that moment, but a lot of times these problems have root causes, and if you're not getting down to that root cause, then unfortunately it's a minor solution.
Absolutely, and that is why it is key that we have strong allies. You know, our community partners and our community nonprofits, we often will pick up the phone. If it's not something that we can do ourselves, we often will pick up the phone and call a trusted resource in the community so that they meet there with that resource at that time.
Absolutely. Now let's shift gears because you have an upcoming Oldies Super Jam concert taking place. Tell us a little bit about when is this concert and who can viewers expect to see?
Sure. The concert is going to be on Sunday, 12th, from 3 to roughly about 2 p.m. This is our first concert ever. We're calling it our Super Jam Oldies for Goodies Mother's Day Concert. It will really just highlight 5 different groups. It's Russell Thompson and the New Stylistics. It's Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes, The Intruders, Will Hart, formerly of the Delphonics, The Prince. And, of course, it's going to be hosted by yours truly, Dr. Bob Lee. The concert is going to be amazing, one, because It is going to, all the proceeds from the event are going to help us in the greater Union County provide more resources for families and our and children. So I'm excited because this is our first ever concert that we have done and we're going to do. And we're just hoping that we have a lot of people that will support this event.
You know, that's so exciting. I think just within the past few months, we've had, you know, Coachella, which is great for, you know, Gen Z generation. We've had Stagecoach this past weekend. And now we have something for all ages, which I think is so exciting. So tell us a little bit about where viewers can get their tickets.
Yeah, they can go online at ucpa.org/event/Virginia Oldies. If they go to the Union County Performing Arts Center, click on events again, and look for the United Way logo. It will say the Super Jam Oldies.
Awesome. Well, be sure to get your tickets because they're not going to last very long after this. But tell us a little bit about what are some other upcoming events that we should be on the lookout for moving forward this year?
Yes, so we are moving. You know, the sad thing is that we are never leaving the city of Elizabeth, New Jersey. We've been having over 5+ years. So we're moving to our Rowway building, and hopefully in the month of June, we'll have a ribbon cutting. So we're excited about that. We're thankful to the city of Rowway for providing us the building. In November, we're going to have our gala celebrating 65 years of dynamic service. We've launched a capital campaign to raise $1.5 million to help with the rehab of this building and also provide services for our community. So those are two big things that we have coming up, but ultimately we need community allies for our capital campaign, for our gala, and also our Super Jam Oldies concert to be successful. So this is my call to action. Please come out and support us. We're doing amazing work. Again, we need these community allies that are going to be our angels and help us really do more work in the coming year.
Absolutely. As we wrap up, I'm going to give you a chance to kind of speak to our viewers. Tell us a little bit about where they can go and what are some ways they can help.
Yeah, so you can go. So any dollar, no dollar is too small for a donation for the United Union County. You can go to our website, www.uwgc.org, and make a donation. Every dollar that you donate, 91 cents goes right back into programming, which is super huge and it's important. You know, our dollars, you know, we literally, as we're a nonprofit. So it is important that when someone donates, they know where their dollars are going. So please visit our website, United Way Greater Union County, and make a donation. No dollar is too small. We will take a dollar, we'll take $25, we'll take $100. Whatever you're able to provide is greatly appreciated.
With that, Julianne, I want to thank you so much for joining us today.
You're welcome. Thank you so much for having me. And I look forward to seeing my community allies in the community. Thank you.
Of course. So that's about all the time we have with Julianne. But stay tuned because when we come back, we'll sit down with our next guest to highlight their mentorship and education programs. You don't want to miss it. Stay tuned.
BronxNet is a wonderful place because it inspires people that want to consider a career in film and television. It's a way to come, learn, it's cost effective, and it's a way to actualize your dreams.
Welcome back. Our next guests are the Associate Director of Corporate Recruitment Partnerships and a mentor with iMentor and Enterprise Sales, Amazon Web Services. They are with us to speak about the programs and services their organization offers to help students achieve their goals. Please welcome to the program Taylor Lewis and Garrett Martinez. Thank you both so much for joining me today.
Thank you for having us. Yeah, we're excited to be here.
Of course, I'm excited to have this conversation. So to kick it off, let's talk about what is iMentor and what are your roles within the organization?
Yeah, of course. So my name is Taylor Lewis. I'm the Associate Director of Corporate Recruitment Partnerships with iMentor NYC, and I'm joined by Garrett Martinez. I'll let him introduce himself.
That's right. So I'm actually a mentor with iMentor and have been for several years now. And I'm also a mentor ambassador for Amazon, which actually just helps expand the mentor footprint within the Amazon world.
Mm-hmm. And how did both of you get involved with the organization?
Yeah, absolutely. So I joined iMentor NYC back in 2019 as a program manager. I was doing direct service work with about 80 to 90 students within our partner schools and their mentors. I was supporting them through the post-secondary application process. And then I transitioned to the recruitment team a couple of years ago, and I've been here ever since. Mm-hmm.
And I've actually been in New York for about 5 years. And when I moved from the West Coast, I wanted to get involved with something that was directly helping the community. And honestly, through word of mouth, I found out about iMentor and the program goals and a one-on-one mentorship with the youth in NYC was just right on to what I was looking for.
Absolutely. And iMentor has a rich history of helping students achieve their goals for over 25 years. So can you tell me, what do you think has led to the organization's success and longevity?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. So we are really proud to be celebrating our 25th anniversary this year. iMentor was founded in 1999. We've served about 42,000 students in that time. But we've really succeeded in building these one-on-one mentoring relationships that allow students to succeed in college and beyond. And we do so through one-on-one mentoring, where we pair every single student within our program with an adult volunteer who supports them with the post-secondary and college application process through a series of weekly online writings and monthly meetings. Mm-hmm. I think one thing that really kind of differentiates us from other mentoring organizations, and one area which we really excel, is our whole school model. Mm-hmm. What I mean when I say that is, whenever iMentor NYC partners with a high school, we commit to working with every single student within that school, regardless of GPA and regardless of post-secondary applications. So if you look at our numbers and if you look at our outcomes, you can see that this program model really does work. Mm-hmm. About 83% of our iMentor NYC students go on to immediately enroll in college after high school, compared to the city average of about 61%. Mm-hmm. So I think this really goes to show that if we want to make big change in our city, we have to be doing this work at a really large scale.
Absolutely, and congratulations on that.
Thank you.
Can either of you share a personal story of maybe somebody you've mentored or a success story that you know of that has come from the program?
Of course. So as I mentioned, I joined the program back in 2019 mm-hmm. as a program manager. My students, unfortunately, were deeply impacted by COVID. My students graduated in 2021. COVID happened spring of their junior year, and so they were obviously faced with a lot of challenges, but so many of them went on to graduate and thrive in their chosen post-secondary pathway, so I'm really proud of that. And I'm also proud of my own mentee within the program. She's a 12th grade student who's getting ready to graduate, so I'm very, very excited for her. Mm-hmm. But I know Garrett has definitely had a lot of experience mentoring in the program on his own.
Yeah, absolutely. So one thing that's pretty special about iMentor is their pairing strategy is very strategic and how many data points they go through. Mm-hmm. You're spending multiple years with this student, so your mentorship goes beyond the curriculum and goes into form a real relationship. My first mentee was a big soccer player, and I've played soccer all my life, so we were able to bond over that. So over those couple of years of mentorship, not only were we focused on getting him into a four-year university, mm-hmm. but he was committed to playing sports in college. And I'm happy to say he's now playing at SUNY Pauley up north, which is great. He's got about to finish his freshman year in a couple months here. But his sort of commitment to the mentorship program, his commitment to school, allowed him to have that opportunity, and now kind of living what he wanted to do. So it's great to see that, especially having been my first mentee in the program.
I think that's so important what you mentioned of like this compatibility test in a
that's
way.
Right.
Because you can have a mentor and you can have a mentee, but if you don't click, it falls flat. And mm-hmm. it's really hard to kind of get through, especially when it's somebody who's younger. It's really hard to get through to them if they don't kind of bond with you in
that's
that
right.
sense. Can you talk about maybe what are some of the minor like data points or things that you go through to make sure that you are compatible?
Do you want to go through
I'm happy to go through it. As a part of the screening process for all of our mentors, they are going to fill out what we call a mentor profile, which is going to ask them a lot of different things about their interests and their hobbies and their career and what they were like in high school. And then as a part of the intake process for all of our iMentor NYC students, they're going to fill out a really, really similar form. Mm-hmm. We then have program managers who are trained college success advisors, and they're going to read through these forms side by side and make matches based off of commonalities. Because what we want to do is, like Garrett said, we want to make sure that every single pair in our program has at least one or two things in common to give them that foundation.
Again, so important. So within the program, let's talk about what are some of the workshops and services that the iMentor program offers to students.
Yeah, absolutely. So I really think there are three key areas in which we excel. Mm-hmm. The first of which is our whole school model, which I mentioned. When we partner with a high school, iMentor NYC commits to working with every single student within that mm-hmm. school. In addition to that, every single student within that school will enroll in a weekly iMentor class for their 11th and 12th grade year. Mm-hmm. Those classes are tailored to be career and college readiness classes, and so every single student within our partner school has access to our curriculum. And those classes are taught by our program managers. Again, they're trained college advisors who are really there to support our students and their mentors through this entire process. And then lastly, once our students graduate, they will all enroll in what we call iMentor College, where the organization will continue to support students for two additional years. Because what we want to do is we want to make sure students are not only enrolling in their chosen pathway, but they have the resources that they need in order to persist. So we're really excited to continue building out this program. And we are actually in the process of partnering with a variety of higher ed institutions across New York State to bring our program and our resources to even more students, particularly first-generation college students within those campuses.
That's so amazing. I think all the programs that are offered really help build that foundation to go to college and higher education after that. Tell me a little bit, how many schools does iMentor partner with?
Yes, so currently iMentor NYC has 11 partner schools. We serve mm-hmm. about 3,000 students within those 11 partner schools. Five of those partner schools are actually located here in the Bronx. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna see if I can do this. We have the Laboratory School of Finance and Technology. We have the Bronx Academy for Software Engineering. Mm-hmm. We have Bronx Law Academy 2. We have the Bronx High School for Law and Community Service, and then we have the Marble Hill High School for International Studies. Those are iMentor NYC's Bronx-based high schools. We do also have six other schools within the other boroughs, and we're actually looking to expand our footprint in the coming year, so stay tuned for more partner schools.
That's so exciting. And just before this, we spoke about the compatibility mm-hmm. to make sure that the mentor and the mentee are compatible. So can you tell me how often do mentors maintain contact with their students after they've graduated?
Yeah, we're really, really excited about this. So about 85% of our mentors choose to stick with their mentees during those 2 years in iMentor College. But beyond that, about 1 in 5 of our mentors choose to return and mentor another high school mentee once their original mentee ages out of the program. Mm-hmm. And that really tells us that these mentors are having such a positive experience within the iMentor NYC program, and they're looking to make another difference in a student's life. Garrett, I know, is on his second mentee right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So my, like I said, my first mentee graduated high school, and he's playing soccer at SUNY Pauley, and we connect every several months. The program mm-hmm. In college is a little bit less structured, but the communication, what you're supposed to be talking about, is really right on for what they would be experiencing as freshman year in college. And now I'm on to a second mentee who's an 11th grader at Bronx Law. Mm-hmm. And it's exciting because it's a whole new relationship, you know, different interests and what they're looking to achieve. And I don't know, it gets me excited to figure out like how I can help him exceed in his life, hit his goals.
It is very exciting. And so we have about less than a minute left to wrap, but in doing so, can you tell us how can viewers at home interested in getting their kids involved with iMentor sign up, and where can we go for more information?
Yes, so any parent who's interested in finding more about iMentor NYC can go to our website, imentor.org, and find a full list of schools that we partner with. But additionally, we are always looking to expand our community of mentors. This year, we are recruiting 1,200 mentors for the upcoming school year within New York City. And mentors are really the lifeline of our program. So I encourage everyone to check us out. We would absolutely love to have you. We need 500 mentors located here in the Bronx. So definitely please go to imentor.org/volunteer to find out more about how you can get involved. We do not require that anyone have mentoring experience or be a college expert. We provide all of our mentors with trainings. Really, it only takes about 3 hours to make a huge difference in a student's life. So again, check us out, imentor.org/volunteer.
Awesome. I want to thank you both so much for sitting down with us today. I feel like we've learned a lot, and this is an amazing program. So congratulations.
Thank you so much for having us.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it.
Thanks.
Thank you. We'll take a quick break and be back with more Open right after this.
Happy anniversary to BronxNet 30 years. Wow, brings back so many memories. This exact studio that I'm in right now, I broadcast out of here. This must have been around 2003. I mean, time flies by so quickly. I started out here with it was either Mr. Gary Axelbank and Mr. Batch with Lady Moore Saab. We used to do a show here called In the Neighborhood. And I brought so many different guests on this show. To be able to bring your voice to the community is very powerful. To bring hip hop and spirituality, I brought my pastor in this same studio, Pastor Geno Jennings, and I'm sure you guys know who Pastor Geno Jennings is. That's rough. And some disciplined teaching. BronxNet is something that we need to uplift our communities, because this is a platform that we can come, and if you have a vision that's in your mind going into your heart, you can use it to do uplifting things for your community.
Congratulations to BronxNet on its 30th anniversary. And I'm blessed that I was here shortly after the beginning of BronxNet. At that time, I took the field and studio classes, and I spent a lot of time helping other people have shows before I put my toe in the water and decided to have a show for myself. For those of you who are familiar with the Blackwash Televised Art Gallery, that was my first show on my own. And now I am pumping up La Finca Del Sur, doing Eating Healthy with La Finca Del Sur on BronxNet's Channel 70. And I appreciate everyone watching.
Welcome back. Our next guest is the daughter of American singer and songwriting legend Bill Withers. She joins us to speak about how she is honoring her father's legacy and to shine a light on her own career in music and much more. Please welcome to the show, Corey Withers. Corey, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi there, thank you. It's great to be here.
So to start things off, let's just talk about, you know, your journey as an artist. Tell us a little bit about that journey, and how would you describe your music and songwriting style?
Oh, wow. Yeah, I grew up singing in the choruses at school. I did the musicals at school. I have an older brother who did the same. So my introduction to music was really kind of classical music, and then I took piano lessons. I think I started around 5. Mm-hmm. And I did that until maybe as a senior in high school, and then my dad got me an acoustic guitar because I had started writing songs, and he wrote a lot of songs on the acoustic guitar, as we know. And so from there, you know, I went off to school in New York. I went to Columbia, and then I went to Tisch, NYU, for musical theater writing. So I just continued to write, and I just always knew I would be a songwriter. And then it was years later that I started singing and doing gigs. I met other songwriters who were singer-songwriters, and they were like, you've never done a gig, you know? And my dad had always really mentored me, you know, in that direction anyway. So, you know, fast forward, now I get the opportunity to sing his music and record his music, which I really love to do, and kind of apply everything that's a part of my own style to his music. And then I have my own songs that I write and record as well.
Yeah, so tell me, how do you think you would intertwine kind of what you learned and what influenced you, and then putting a spin on it with your own style? Tell me a little bit about that.
So I think for me, the difference between just my dad's influence as a mentor, as a songwriter, and as a singer, and my own kind of journey is just there was probably a little bit more jazz involved. Mm-hmm. My brother listened to a lot of jazz vocalists, like Ella Fitzgerald, and Dad talked about Carmen McRae. And then when Jose James, who's a jazz artist, started performing Dad's music, he did an album called Lean On Me, and he invited me to sing with him. And I got to perform with his band, and I sort of saw that, you know, modern jazz is really an outlet for soul and hip hop and blues and all these different styles of music. Of course, Latin jazz is huge, Brazilian jazz, you know, that the kind of diaspora of music that I was always interested in, West African music, you know, that it all kind of was coming together in that community. And then you have just the best musicians, you know, in the world globally. So I think once I started seeing that I could apply improvising and my sort of softer feminine voice to Dad's music, and that the musicians would also play with changing the harmonic structure or the rhythm groove to make it something different that includes our influences since Dad made his recordings. So it becomes this kind of new thing that's kind of a collage of his foundation and then kind of the popular song influences, the classical jazz, you know, blues, rock song influences that we all kind of have. And so it's this conversation between me and the band or whatever guest vocalist, or if I may be a guest of someone else, it's just this conversation of music where Dad's writing and his compositions, the focus. It was really fun. I feel very privileged to be, you know, in a position to get the job to do this, because it's really rewarding for me. I tried for a long time to convince Dad that he should be, you know, working with other singers mm-hmm. that would love to work with him. And he really was interested in the mentorship relationship with me, and so it's really nice now to be that, you know, the student that gets to perform and record with people that are, you know, at his caliber. Really, really special for our family.
Yeah, absolutely. It's so funny because in the segment before we did discuss another mentorship program of people who had mentors preparing them in high school and in college. So I think it shows just how important mentorship is in any field. And like you mentioned, I think it's so great that you're able to kind of put your own spin on your father's music and kind of hone in on your gifts and what you do really well, and then able to, you know, intertwine that. So I think that's really exciting. But aside from that, you also have a children's book that recently came out called Grandma's Hands. What inspired this book?
Well, the book was inspired by the publisher who published a book with my mother, Marcia, who runs the publishing company and has since 1975, I think. And basically, his name is Joel Harper, and he had a book called Frankie Finds the Blues that was about his experience with his grandmother introducing him to the blues. And it's this gorgeous art book of this little boy with his guitar and his grandmother and this journey and beautifully written text. And he said, I'd really like to do a book with you guys based on Bill's music. And Dad thought it was great, Mom thought it was great. And so fast forward, you know, post-COVID, the book is finished and we worked with this incredible artist, Gregory Christie. And my mother is a lifelong art lover. So for her, it was a great opportunity to work with a real painter. And he sent us some sketches and we talked about, you know, sort of like the composition of what would be included in the book. We decided to just use the lyrics as is and not make any changes. And then Gregory went to work and did his paintings. And so each page really is a standalone art piece that could go in a frame in your home, and we hope, you know, will. And he has prints, you know, that he's made available. So it's just been so rewarding for us to connect visual art and literature and the family, you know, because mm-hmm. for me, it's my actual great grandmother. So it's so personal. And Dad said this was his favorite song. So that it's just really special for us to do this. And then in the back of the book, there's sheet music. If anyone plays the piano or the guitar or sings and wants to include that in their experience in their home. And there's a bio of Dad and a picture of him when he's 12 in his bomber jacket, his flight jacket. He's so adorable. And then his grandmother, Lula, and some information about her. So we're just really proud to have this available for families, because grandmothers are so important to families of all religions, races, creeds, genders. I mean, all over the world throughout history, you know, just grandmothers have been such a special force in the community to be there for children and to be there for parents. And that's one of the things Dad talks about in the song, you know, grandma's hand soothed the local unwed mother, that, you know, that this is a place, this is a home where she can go and have something to eat, have someone to talk to, get some advice on how to raise her child. And the child is having a better experience because they're at grandma's house. The woman who's raising the child is having a better experience, you know. And, you know, for Dad as a young man or as a boy to remember that is really special, you know, to connect women and also to connect him. You know, he stuttered as a kid, and it was something that at the time and in the place where he was, and still today, there's such a stigma about it. And so people are bullied. And there's a wonderful organization we work with called SAY, the Stuttering Association for the Young. And they provide camp and theater activities and programs for kids to perform so that they get an opportunity to express their personalities, because people, you know, sort of a lot of times tell people who stutter to be quiet or don't have the patience to wait for them to speak. And so Dad carried for the rest of his life that feeling of having been hurt. And he always kind of identified as an underdog. He identified with people with disabilities, identified with people with compassion and empathy. And it just was a big part of his character that he was a child who stuttered. So his grandmother was someone who supported him when the community didn't understand that it wasn't a reflection of his intelligence or his artistry or his personality at all. It was just something that affected his speech. So for him to be able to express himself in music, as, you know, many kids who stutter do, where they can rap, stuttering, it doesn't affect that. You sing, stuttering doesn't affect that, just scientifically. And it's a real outlet. And a lot of people may not know that about stuttering. So for him, he poured himself into music because it was a place where he could have a freedom that he didn't have in speech. And I think he was just really proud of that relationship, that something that people would think made you unintelligent or unable to express yourself was an advantage. And so we're really proud to participate with that organization, SAY, because they provide opportunities for more kids like Dad to express themselves and to be heard. And they have writers, singers, musicians, performers, you know, little scientists and mathematicians, and they're in New York. So we're just really proud of that. And we actually have Everett Bradley, who works with that organization, who's going to play percussion with us at the show at City Vineyard that we, you know, we'll talk about for our Mother's Day luncheon event. To support the book, and we'll be doing book signings, which are really, book signings are really an opportunity for people to share their grandma stories with us as we dedicate the book to someone in their family or even to them personally. So book signings are a great opportunity for us as a family to receive stories from people of times they saw dad perform, the records they have, you know, things that I wouldn't know as the daughter or my mom wouldn't know, because we as his family came along, you know, just before he was going to retire, before his last, you know, album or two. So mm-hmm. it's just a wonderful, wonderful time for us to come to New York and celebrate the book and celebrate dad's relationship with his grandmother and to celebrate mothers and grandmothers, you know, all at the same time.
You know, I think that's such a beautiful message from the book. And I think it's also a testament, you know, what you were saying about your father and his struggles. I think that's just such a testament to how important the arts are. I'm a huge advocate for arts, especially for the children and in schools. So I think it's so important. And I really do think that this book will just be another tool to help with that. I think that's amazing. And with that, you know, let's talk a little bit about how your father's song Ain't No Sunshine has just been honored and recognized. Tell me a little bit about that.
So the song was recognized in Washington, D.C. at the Library of Congress. And it's in the National Recording Registry class of 2024. So we congratulate dad as a grad this year. And it's just really special for that song because Ain't No Sunshine was the first single off of dad's first album in 1971 called Just As I Am, recorded in Los Angeles where he moved after he just, you know, got out of the Navy in San Jose. He came here to get into the music business and he was working in factories and doing demos, got his recording contract, made this record with Booker T. Jones, and this was the single that really was the first hit. And the single that they put out first was a song called Harlem, which is one of my absolute favorite songs. It talks about the nightlife in Harlem and people going to church in the morning. And it's just like a really wonderful groove song. And so they thought, okay, this is upbeat. We'll make this the first single. And, you know, the 45s that they had for the DJs were the way that they distributed the music. And DJs started flipping the record over to the B-side, which was usually a song they kind of had as sort of a throwaway, you know, the B-Squad, and that was the one that people connected to, that the DJs connected to, and they started playing and people wanted to hear, and then he was on the Johnny Carson show, you know, after he'd been laid off from his job. So the song is representative of dad's, you know, musicianship and his songwriting, but it really is the focal point of his transition from grandma's baby, who was a sailor, you know, who could sing, to being someone who the public would connect to, who was going to have a career and a journey of relationships with musicians and producers. You know, people and listeners, and that the music would continue to this day. So we know that, you know, Sunshine is a song that people sing when you're first starting out playing gigs. It's you know, an easy song to sing. It has a narrow range, so you don't have all these high notes to be able to show off. And it has a really unique melody. It's an accessible song. And then there's this section with the 26 I knows that he says, where he wanted to write some lyrics, and then Booker T. Jones, the producer, said, no, leave it like that. And that's become something unique about that song, and I think probably was at the time that he did that. So it's just very cool and special to have that be recognized as sort of a national gem at the Library of Congress. We have a lot of family in Washington, D.C. It's very special for us personally. And we're, of course, very proud of dad, you know, to come from grandma's arms and hands and her tambourine, you know, to bring that to honor her. And when I sing the song and I know for maybe other people, you know, Ain't No Sunshine When She's Gone, even though it's originally written about a relationship, you can relate that to that grandmother who you've lost.
Yeah, I think that is such a beautiful message. And I think because we do have less than a minute left, so before we do wrap up, I just want to congratulate you on this book and just on all the successes, and we do wish it the best.
Thank you so much. And we hope people come out to the show. It's May 12th at City Vineyard, which is different from City Winery. We're going to have lunch, music, book signing, conversation, storytelling. And it's 12 o'clock. Pier 26, 233 West Street. And I have to mention Valerie Simpson is going to be our guest, who's going to sing Lean On Me with me. She's an incredible musician and a legend. And we hope to see you there. It's always a thing to find something new to do for Mother's Day, something new to give. And we hope that this experience, at City Vineyard will be an opportunity for you to have a new kind of Mother's Day. So please join us. And then we're going to be at the New York Public Library May 10th, which is a Friday, at 10:30 a.m. doing a book reading. And then we'll be at Grandma's Place Bookstore at 3:30 doing book reading and signing, and that's 84 West 120th Street. The New York Public Library, of course, is 9 West 124. Thank you. Happy Mother's Day to all you moms and grandmas.
Awesome. We have to take a quick break, but don't go anywhere. We'll be back with more Open right after this. Welcome back. Our last guests are a Harlem, New York native gospel singer, actress, and advisory board member of the African American Day Parade, a writer, director, and producer. She sits down with us to highlight her latest project, The Ushers, and is joined by two of the actresses of the production. Please welcome to the show Ms. Veronica Hickman, Tasada Aird, and Amanda Brinton.
Hello.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Hi. Thanks for having us.
I'm so excited to talk with you guys. So just tell me a little bit about yourselves and the thought process behind The Ushers. How did that come about?
Okay, so for me, I usually like write plays or do skits. Mm-hmm. We all go to church together. Mm-hmm. So these are like my sisters, my friends. Mm-hmm. And I kept, when I see things that are funny, I start getting ideas. Like I can hear God laughing going, that would be funny, that would be funny. So I kept sharing with my friends, like, oh, it would be so funny to do a play about ushers, and then mm-hmm. show the real behind the scenes things about ushers. So as I would tell them the different ideas, they would start laughing. And I'm like, oh, I think we can really do this. Mm-hmm. So that's how that started. Yeah.
That's so much fun. Tell us a little bit about the two of you.
Yes, for me, this acting skit that I'm going to be playing in is the morologist. What a morologist is somebody who sees something mm-hmm. that is so sad mm-hmm. and they start crying dramatically, mm-hmm. And morologists, they are very outspoken. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They are very outspoken, and I come from a family who is very outspoken.
Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Amanda Brinton. I'm playing the part as Miss Bertha. Miss mm-hmm. Bertha is the person who her...
You can't give all of it away, but go ahead.
Her person, somebody passes away. Mm-hmm. So that's who Miss Bertha is. This opportunity is by far amazing for me. I'm just happy to be in this play, and I'm so thankful to my sister in Christ, Veronica, really, really am. I used to be an actor when I was a little girl, and mm-hmm. I also went to high school for drama. So to have my foot back in the door again, like, this is amazing. Like, I'm excited, really, really excited. And again, I thank my sister Veronica,
I'm glad you
so
in it.
Much.
Yes.
Well, listen, you all seem like a very fun bunch to work with, oh, yeah. just off of this. So tell me, what were the audition processes like for this play?
To be honest with you, I didn't really have auditions because I know my friends. So when I would think of different characters, I would say, this person would be good for this. Mm-hmm. And I would go, oh, that person could do this. And even with her part. Now, what she didn't tell you with the morologist, which makes her part fun, is that we'd have a funeral scene in the show. Okay. And what happens is people, you know, you come to a funeral, you cry. But a morologist is a professionally paid person who grieves for the family. Right. So when she comes in, she's doing all this crying all over the place. And then she sits in the back. Mm-hmm. Because she feels like she just did her job. Mm-hmm. So she does, you know, things like that. Not that she's a morologist in real life, but I just love her energy and the things that she does or whatever. But, yeah, a lot of the characters are based, like, we have a usher called Sister Pocketbook, mm-hmm. right? Sister Pocketbook, she keeps the pocketbook wherever she goes. Mm-hmm. So if she going downstairs, her pocketbook is with her. She going to the bathroom, the pocketbook is with her. And that's me. That's really me because I've lost phones and wallets. Mm-hmm. So every time when I go, like, my pocketbook is right over there. So when I go places, I keep my pocketbook with me. So a lot of it is like real life stories mm-hmm. all mixed into one.
But that sounds so fun, though. I already know this is something that so many people are going to want to see. So tell us, where and when is it debuting?
It's going to be May 11th,
okay.
A place called Dear Mama Coffee, mm-hmm. around 126th Street and Broadway. Mm-hmm. I'm so excited about it because when we actually advertised it on Eventbrite, because we talked about it so much, mm-hmm. when we put it on, the tickets are free.
Okay.
Unfortunately, though, the show was already sold out, right? Okay. Because when we put it on Eventbrite, people, at 12 o'clock it went on April mm-hmm. 2nd, and by April 3rd, the tickets were all gone because it was an 80-seat place, 80-seat seater. And people can come. They can order coffee. They can get, like, a bagel. They can order food. Mm-hmm. And then they get to enjoy. We are asking for donations, okay. but there's no pressure to give it. Mm-hmm. So we're going to do it. So we started a wait list also. Mm-hmm. So if people, we have enough people now that we can do a second show. We're just working on a location right now and a date.
Isn't that so exciting?
Oh.
Like, you know, you let it out, you put this up on Eventbrite, and already tickets are sold out. Like, isn't that so exciting?
Thank God.
Speaking of, tell us, how important is it for you to connect to the faith-based community through productions like this?
Ooh. Okay, I know I've been talking for a while, and if you want to elaborate on that.
For me, the importance is at a high, high level. Mm-hmm. You know, you get to show your... sisters in Christ, brothers in Christ, and even the community, mm-hmm. There's what we study, mm-hmm. we're more than just, you know.
Performers.
Right, performers, right. More than just speaking of God. Mm-hmm. We want to show you our talents. Right. We want to show you what we can do, what we're made of. So mm-hmm. For me, It's good. It's you're showing the community, you're showing your sisters and brothers in Christ. Mm-hmm. So it's a good thing. It's a really, really good thing.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Tisada?
Yes. For me, it really brings more unity.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You know, it brings more unity, brings more love, joy, peace, you know. And it really, really, really gets more people to really come out and see.
Mm. Yes.
You know, more people to come out and see so that way they can relate to it as well. You know?
Yeah. It's good.
So.
Yeah. Absolutely. And, you know, when it comes to productions like this, there is a whole team that goes behind it. So are there any shout outs that you want to give?
Oh, boy. Okay. So wait, I told you I was going to show you my Mickey Mouse ears. These are my Mickey Mouse ears, right? So when I direct mm-hmm. I sometimes, so I don't get too serious, mm-hmm. I put my ears on. Like, I started wearing them last week to let them mm-hmm. know that I'm starting to get serious.
Yeah.
So part of this is my production team right here.
Okay.
So I can keep my mind set. I have young lady named Imani. Shout outs mm-hmm. to Imani and to Michelle Green, mm-hmm. to Anne Marie and Linda. These are people who are helping me out behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. You know, we even have a lady, and her name is Lou Cellini Sierra. She's an actual professional model, but mm-hmm. she used to help out with the pageants, teach the people how to walk, and she's a host. So she does a lot of stuff, but she helped me with getting like the copyright for the play. Right. So now the play is copyright, so nobody can take my play. I'm so excited about that. And you know, but everybody on the crew and the cast just gives their all. So it's just like there's like almost 30 people in the cast. Okay. So everybody does their part, and mm-hmm. that's what's making it. I didn't have my friends, my sisters in Christ, and this show would not happen because we didn't have a budget.
Yeah.
It was just like, can you do this? Do you mind volunteering? Do you mind helping out? Can you help make some scripts? Can you do? Oh, it's Charmin. Charmin mm-hmm. helped us to do scripts, use all her copy paper and everything. So, yeah. And of course, to God.
Amen.
This couldn't have happened without God, right. for sure.
Right.
That's amazing. Yes. That is. Again, when it comes to productions, there's a whole team that goes behind it. And just quickly, as we wrap up, let's go down the line. Let's talk about where people at home can follow your work and if there's anything new that you have coming up.
Okay, so my Instagram page is mm-hmm. Veronica_Hickman4. Mm-hmm. They can check me out over there. Mm-hmm. And they can DM me if they want more information about things that I'm doing. Right now, currently, with the play, we're mm-hmm. also part of the choir. Mm-hmm. She's in the choir.
Yes.
Eventually, one day, maybe you'll join the choir again. But we'll be doing a gospel concert mm-hmm. at Riverbank State Park on September 7th. It's a free outdoor concert. Mm-hmm. And it's almost like a gospel variety show because we'll have praise dancers, poetry, people, soloists who will be singing. Mm-hmm. And we just have a really good time. It's like almost our 15th year there.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're excited about that. Awesome. Yeah.
Desada?
Yes. So what was the question?
Oh, where can we find you on social media?
I spoke so much. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Yes. Yes. So you can find me on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And
with the name that I have
on my Facebook page is Tassada. Mm-hmm. You know, and when you look on it, you know, you will see my face mm-hmm. with my family. With my mama and my father and my sister, mm-hmm. you know, I give a shout out to my mother, you know, mm-hmm. Queen Makita is what I call her. Queen Makita is what I call her, and I give a shout out to my father, mm-hmm. and I give a shout out to my sister, Sheba, aka Falasha, you know, and I give a shout out to Keen, Derek, all of my family. I love you guys so much unconditionally.
Amen. Awesome.
Yes.
Awesome. We have about a minute left, so Amanda, where can we find you?
You could just go to Facebook or Instagram and Amanda Britton. No pet names or anything like that. just Amanda Britton. Again, I'm just excited for this opportunity. I'm glad to be back home in Harlem.
Yes. She was living in Queens for a while.
I'm glad to, I'm about to be a grandma.
Yes.
So good things are going for me right now. So I'm just excited.
That's awesome. Congratulations again on
Thank
the play.
You.
Thank you for
so
joining
much.
Us today. So unfortunately, that is all the time we have today. I want to thank our guests for joining us and you, the viewers, for tuning in. Keep following BronxNet TV for any continued coverage. You may join our hosts, Kibben Aline, Darren Jaime, and Rena Valentin for new episodes of Open Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday. I'll see you next time.